Okay, our final keynote speaker for this afternoon comes from New Zealand. We've got with us Chorus's head of networks, Martin Churik. And of course, Chorus, for those not familiar with the Australian model, is the national provider of broadband infrastructure and generally broadband services. So if I could welcome Martin, please, to the stage.
Hi everyone, it's good to be following GAB. We've worked together for many years now. It's been a collaborative arrangement between NBN and Chorus for quite a long time, so it's good to be here. First of all, you can probably tell I have an English accent. I do have a British passport. I'm also a Kiwi, so I have a New Zealand passport, and I'm proud of what my nationality is. What does this mean? This means that I can't be an Australian politician. And what this means for today is that I'm going to talk not about politics, but about networks. And I'm going to back up my discussion about networks with real data and real insight. So not a projection of the future on what I think, a projection of the future based upon what's actually happening in our network today. Right, the clicker, the infamous clicker. This is New Zealand, coincidentally next to the UK. If you go 3 hours to the east of here, you hit New Zealand. Australians think of New Zealand as a very small island somewhere in the Pacific that is much, much smaller than Australia. We are. But we're actually just a bit bigger than UK and not far off the same size as France. We're quite a large country from a European context. What's the big difference? The big difference is we only have a population of 5 million people. Vis-a-vis European countries that have populations of 60 or 70 million people in the same landmass. Building broadband to us brings a lot of the same challenges that you've heard today, but it also brings some unique challenges of trying to cover such a dispersed population. So, I think it's very hard not to talk about fibre if you live in New Zealand. I'm going to spend just 2 slides talking about fibre, updating on where we are, and then I'll quickly move on to some more topics that I think are perhaps particularly pertinent considering today's conversation. So the New Zealand government said we should build fibre to 75% of the population, and that's what we're doing. We've just got over halfway in the build, going very well, and this year that has been extended to 87% of the population. So we're going from the very large towns and cities down to some quite small towns and cities in New Zealand. You'll see the trajectory now will continue at around about 100, 120,000 premises passed per year until around about 2021 when the build starts to drop off and we start to build the more remote places. Ultimately for New Zealand, this will mean approximately 1.5 million premises when you include greenfields will actually have access to UFB. For interest, the take up today is not far off 40% of all the premises passed so far to date. We've approximately reached 40%. So for us, there's two things. There's Auckland and there's not Auckland. Auckland is 2 million people. Auckland is almost half of New Zealand's population. We will finish Auckland in approximately 2 years' time. Then everybody in Auckland will be able to connect to fibre if they choose to do so. And then we'll then spend the next 5 years trying to connect some very, very small places in New Zealand. These are very small places. We're talking populations of 300, 400, 500, 1,000 people per population. What has helped enormously is New Zealand's FTTN program. So you can imagine that fibre was taken to all of these places previously. From 2011 onwards, we had the program for FTTN, followed by the program for rural broadband. So fibre was taken quite deep into New Zealand and the colonisation programme followed behind. We're now following behind this with deployment of fibre. So this was last week. Took this out of our visualisation database last week. What does this mean? The blue is UFB, the 75% of the first phase. The purple is UFB2. Probably interestingly as well, the purple dots underneath that coverage and around the coverage is VDSL. Chorus is not running one network, we're running two networks. We're very much running a fibre network, but we're also running a copper network. And the interesting thing here is that VDSL migrations continue at pace. fibre connections continue at pace. New Zealand is migrating rapidly to two technologies, VDSL and fibre. The clicker's working. What does this mean from a growth perspective? We've got enormous growth currently in broadband in New Zealand. We're not unique, you've heard that today, but we think we have pretty good growth in New Zealand. The average connection speed on our network is 60 megabits per second. That's double 18 months ago. The data on the network is doubling every 18 months. That's more, I think Jeff said earlier on, 49% compound annual interest, compound annual growth rate. We're exceeding that every 18 months, and we don't see a reason why that shouldn't continue. Fibre to the home connections have doubled in 18 months. We see this increasing. We'll meet this trajectory probably for the next year, and they'll start to tail off as we hit a finite trajectory, i.e., like Bruno said earlier on, we simply cannot connect more people because of the workforce constraints in New Zealand. But it's not just fibre. It's copper as well. When we launched VDSL, the maximum speed was 70 megabits per second, depending on attenuation, depending on distance. We now have maximum speeds on copper of 145 megabits per second using vectoring, using technologies like dynamic line management, using technologies like impulse noise protection. We're getting and we're developing a really good copper network in New Zealand. Probably more interestingly to Australians, we still carry 50% more data on our copper network than we do on our fibre network. Yes, it's changing. It will balance over time, but the copper network still carries more data today than the fibre network does. 60,000 VDSL connections or migrations in 3 months, that's a lot. It's actually just more than the number of fibre connections we did in the same period. So you can see very clearly that we're not just a fibre network, we're a copper network, we're a high-speed copper network, and we're a high-speed fibre network. There we go, super clicker. So that's it for focusing specifically on fibre. I want to talk about two things, two really important things. One is migrations, and the other one is capacity. So first of all, migrations. You've seen that we're migrating ADSL to VDSL to fibre. Different things are happening in different parts of the country. You look at Auckland today, Auckland is growing in the purple. There's more VDSL connections every day, every week, every month in Auckland. There's more green, there's more fibre connections happening in New Zealand, in Auckland, every week, every month. If you look closely at the dots, you can see some interesting trends. Where we haven't finished the fibre rollout, you can see the purple is quite dense. Can see we have some very, very active migrations to faster copper broadband, some very good VDSL coverage and speeds in New Zealand. But you can also see where the green is quite dense, that we're starting to migrate. People are starting to migrate not only off ADSL, but migrating off VDSL. Ultimately, this will be all green, but it will take time. I think Mike from Openreach said fibre is the end game, and we do believe fibre is the end game, but this will take time. And just to illustrate the change, 2012, there were zero VDSL connections in Auckland. 5 years later, we've got tens of thousands of VDSL connections. This change has been a fast change, and it continues to be a fast change. To look at this in a different way, this is a graph showing the type of connections in New Zealand, and also contrasted on top is the connection speed. You can see that back in 2012, it was all ADSL. The whole network was ADSL too. And now we're very fast moving towards being a blue GPON network and a green VDSL2 network. The future, just project this forward, you can see where it's going. New Zealand will be a VDSL network. New Zealand will be a fibre network. The purple line's interesting. This is the connection speed. For every connection we move to faster copper, for every connection we move to faster fibre, the average connection speed goes up, and we will bus through an average of 100 megabits per second within 18 months. An example, this is Northcote on Auckland's North Shore. This is an example of migrations from ADSL2 to VDSL2. This is actual network data from last week. There's no fibre here, and you can see that the inner city people of Auckland have embraced VDSL2. It's not been easy. Sometimes modems have to be changed. Sometimes people don't have the education on broadband to understand they need to change. So we've had to campaign to try and get people to take up better broadband. But now the migration is really, really flowing. and there's less and less ADSL2 connections and more VDSL. These people will ultimately migrate to fiber. This is Blenheim. Blenheim has the highest uptake of fiber in New Zealand. They're just about tipping 50% take-up and connection of fiber. The build is complete, and you can see that VDSL is disappearing, ADSL is disappearing. This is an example of what will happen other places in New Zealand all the time. And finally, we're promoting it. We're advertising it. We're actually stimulating it. You can go to our website at any time and see what speed your connection is. You can see what speed your connection you can get. You can see whether you can get fiber. Despite this, some people simply don't want to move. Yeah? So we have to actually work hard to stimulate people to move. Capacity. There is no point having a gigabit per second connection, a 100 megabit per second connection, or a 25 megabit per second connection if you don't have enough capacity. This is our network. Overall, we actually carry at peak hour just over 1,300 gigabits per second at peak hour of data on the network, and it's going up. Peak hour is between 6 p.m. and 10 p.m., as somebody said earlier on. We have to manage the network for this part of the day. If we don't, video starts to buffer, web pages slow down, people have problems with their performance. Regardless of their connection speed, if we don't manage this, the internet will not work as it should do. Is this the reason? Yes and no, I think, is the answer. I think it was Bill earlier on that said Netflix launched 2 years ago and we saw a big uptick in the traffic on the network. We agree. But just to try and illustrate with real data, I'm a network person. This is my house. This is my house in October, the last month. And actually, Netflix is only about 25% of the data on my home network. You can see that there's other types of video. There's uploading into the cloud, there's gaming. Netflix is a big part of the data consumption, but there's other things that are informing this at the same time. Right, the interesting one. This is connection speed in the whole network, mapped against data usage, mapped into three technology types, ADSL, VDSL, and fiber. Three insights. If you're on ADSL, you do use less data, but you can still chew through, on average, 150 gigabytes per month. People that have a slower connection will find a way to use more data. They'll download overnight, they'll wait for a video to start, but they will use more data. 25 megabits per second seems to be around about the point where people start to use the same data right across the board. From 25 to 100 megabits per second, people use approximately 200 to 250 gigabytes per month. Third insight, people that buy high-speed plans use lots of data, and it's pull and push. Buy a high-speed plan, they use more data. They buy a high-speed plan because they want to use more data. Interestingly, in New Zealand as well, over 90% of our new fibre connections are 100 megabits per second, so the 50 is a little bit of a misnomer, but it is slightly lower than fibre, than copper, but not many people actually use the 50 megabit per second fibre plan in New Zealand. Will this grow? Yes, it will. Vodafone last week launched Vodafone TV. Vodafone TV is a diskless set-top box, everything in the cloud. Personally, we still get our sports from Sky over satellite, despite our 600 gigabytes of data per month. Once we move to Vodafone TV, and I will, all of the Sky content starts to move over my network, over the broadband network, along with all the rest of the terrestrial TV. So all this, sports rights are changing. Typically, where sports were always on satellite or on cable, sports are changing to the internet. So let's predict the future. This is the top 10%, the 90th percentile of actual users on our network. You can see that still, the orange line of ADSL, they're finding ways to use more data, 300, 400 gigabytes per month. Those on VDSL above 25 megabits per second, those on 100 megabit per second fiber, are finding ways to use 500 or 600 gigabytes per month. Those on high-speed fiber are using a terabyte per month. This is my prediction of the future. This is the top percent of our network. I believe that in 18 months, in 2 years, this will be the average of what people are starting to use on the network. And they'll use it whether they're at 25 megabits per second, 200 megabits per second or 1 gigabit per second. Quickly and finally, as we just go through, peak hour is really important. New Zealand has got independent testing of what happens at peak hour. Over 2 years, fixed operators have started to make sure their networks are congestion free. This data is for all fixed technologies in the bottom left, but there are also graphs per RSP. Every RSP is measured for their performance at peak hour. Suddenly, all the fixed RSPs are performing congestion free at peak hour. Chorus is congestion free. All the RSPs are congestion free. We're all measured as congestion free. Guess what? The experience improves. The only ones that are slightly lower is fixed wireless, and we all understand that contention on fixed wireless, so they do get slight problems in peak hour. We all recognize these on the front of your fridge or your washing machine. This is our version of that same data. We've got about 10,000 links in the Chorus network. Not handovers to RSPs, links inside our network. We tell RSPs, we tell the government, we tell anyone that's interested what's currently happening on our network. All of our network remains congestion-free and remains green. It's imperative for us to do that to make sure the network performs as well as it possibly can do. And we expose this. We tell everyone that's interested how the Chorus network is actually performing. Just one final thing. It's all very well Chorus having a great network and the RSPs having a great network if the Wi-Fi doesn't work very well. No one's really touched too much on Wi-Fi today, but really, really believe that Wi-Fi needs to improve and the education on Wi-Fi needs to improve. One thing that we announced last week, Chorus is trying to work to take fiber into the school, but not just into the school, but into the classroom. Imagine if the school's network was completely taken out of the way and you had fiber to every single classroom in New Zealand and a Wi-Fi hotspot in every classroom. That would make a huge difference to everyone's performance in the education network. So to finish, we believe in a congestion-free network. We've got a congestion-free network. We're working really closely with the RSP community to make sure they have a congestion-free network. And we've started working really, really closely with the Wi-Fi network to try and make sure that not only schools, but others can actually have a congestion-free Wi-Fi experience as well. Oops. That's it.
Fantastic. Thanks, Martin. Again, do we have any questions in the room for Chorus? Okay, I'll ask you one as well. Clearly, Chorus have got a mixed technology network, so ADSL, VDSL, and fiber. What's your view on mobile being part of a broadband strategy?
So, I mean, like Mike was saying, Chorus has got a lot of asset that is very relevant to mobile. We've got hundreds of thousands of poles. We already provide backhaul fibre to cell sites all over New Zealand. And we're also thinking about how we can get power to poles or use power that is already at poles. So, you know, we do believe that cellular networks will densify. When they have to densify is another question. We don't believe that's anytime soon. Perhaps 4 years, 5 years, 6 years, 7 years from our modeling, you might find that from a capacity perspective, mobile networks have to densify. And at that point, we believe we can form an important part of the ecosystem to help New Zealand build a fantastic mobile network.